nothing into the world, and we take nothing out. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is his faithfulness. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Here we gather at St. Paul's to remember before God our brother Peter. Now, in so doing, we need to not only remember Peter, but also those who are not physically here with us today. So, Toppy, we welcome you, and also welcome all those who in prayer and in remembrance are with us in spirit. We meet in the name of Jesus Christ, who was raised to glory of God the Father, and in his name, each one of us can know grace and mercy and peace with us, even in this hour. As we come here today, we're going to remember before God our brother Peter. We're going to give thanks for his life, and we're going to commend him to God, who is our merciful Redeemer and Judge. And all through this, we will comfort one another in our grief. But as we begin, let us first pray. God of all consolation, your Son, Jesus Christ, was moved to tears at the grave of Lazarus, his friend. And in your infinite mercy and justice and love, you judge us and hold us and everything you have made. So in your mercy, we ask you to turn the darkness of death into the dawn of new life and the sorrow of parting into the joy of heaven. Through our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. So please, take up your sheets and sing praise loudly. Praise my soul, the King of Heaven.
Mercy, ever lasting.
Now, a more kind and gentle man you could not ask to meet than Mr. Peter Cooper. It is a privilege to have known him, and his light and his joyfulness and his faith and his peace shine through, and everybody knows that. So today, we are sad, but we are not going to be miserable if we can possibly help it. Peter would occasionally say to me, "I want to say a rude word." And I said, "Permission granted." There are times absolutely when we are crushed. But Peter and Barbara also know, like many of us do, that we have a God who leads us into new life. New life is a discovery that we all make at different times in our life. The message of Jesus, we might have been taught as children, but to own it as adults, well, we each come to it in our own way. Today, I'm going to give us all an opportunity, though, to lay aside everything that keeps us from God. For on days like today, it isn't just the sadness that keeps us down. It is all the things that we wish we'd got round to doing and the things that we wish we hadn't got round to doing. So I'm going to give us a moment of silence just to lay them down, to say to God, "This is who I am." And also to say to God, "In Jesus, please take it, because I can't carry it." Let's take a moment before our loving Heavenly Father to ask his forgiveness, knowing that, like Peter, he is gentle and full of compassion. God of mercy, we acknowledge before you the imperfection of our lives and the brokenness we feel today. We turn from the wrong that we've thought and said and done. And of course today we're called to mind all the things that we fail to do. For the sake of Jesus who died for us, forgive us all that is past. And help us now to live each day in the light of Christ our Lord. Amen. So may God our Father forgive us and bring us to the eternal joy of his kingdom, where dust and ashes have no power. So in the light of that love of God, let's bring to him what we actually are looking for today. Merciful Father, hear our prayers and comfort us. Renew our trust in your Son, whom you raised from the dead, and strengthen our faith that all who have died in the love of Christ will share in his resurrection, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. I'm going to ask Tom to come and share with us memories of Peter to add to our own special memories.
In a man is often based on the position that he rises to in society. But I believe that greatness in a man is best measured by how much better the world is because of his influence on others. Accordingly, I'm sure that all of you, together with the hundreds of others who couldn't be here today, will agree that Peter Cooper was a great man. Peter was a caring, loving person who brought out the best in others, and was truly happiest when he saw others succeed. People who have met Peter don't just recall the occasion, they remember it fondly, as a pleasant episode in their life. Peter has accumulated innumerable friends with such strong bonds that they would say, and do say, that they loved him, and he made the world a better place. I've never heard from a side word what I found truly remarkable was that this pleasant, caring manner was not just for friends and acquaintances, but was extended to people that he would encounter in his day-to-day life. Whether it was a friend, a shopkeeper, a taxi driver, or a waiter he'd never met before, Peter would have a kind word to say and show a genuine interest in his well-being. Outgoing, curious, and friendly, he would have a complete stranger feeling like the most important person in the world in a short space of time. How did such a remarkable man become the true gentleman that we know? There are a few clues along the way, but the keys for me are that he loved and was loved and was honest. You could take him at his word and be confident. There was no hidden agenda. Peter was born on August 31st, 1934, to his father Edmund Cooper and mother Mary Kirkland Cooper, 2 years after Brother Kirk. Much of his early life was spent in New Jersey, where his father was working for the Macy's organization and served in the Royal Navy during World War II. Summers, however, were spent back in Bermuda, Bayswater, on Pitts Bay, with his uncle and aunt and his grandparents, which Peter recalled as a special time for the young brothers. After World War II, the family moved back to Bermuda. He did, however, continue his schooling in the U.S. at Eagle Brook, Westminster, and New York University. He met the love of his life, Barbara Hutchings, when he was 15 years old, and they married in 1955. Earlier this year, Peter and Barbara celebrated their 67th anniversary. One of the often told family stories is on the occasion when they first met. Yes, Barbara was attracted to the young teenager, but what really first caught his eye was her moped. So much so that he didn't ask her out on a date, but rather if he could have a ride on her Vila Solex. He did, however, overcome his distraction with the bike in time to realize that he should ask her out. Barbara and Peter both reminisced recently how they fell in love dancing, following the Talbot brothers across the island wherever they played. It was a wonderful love affair that continues to be inspirational to many, including me, for their complete devotion to one another, the good times and bad. Peter was dedicated to the family they built together, his daughters, Beth and Tina and son Summers, and his grandchildren, Ashley, Peter, Adrian, Cooper, Katie, Mackenzie, Julia, Chase, and Ellis. But in the same caring, inclusive manner, he treated Dee, Kevin Stevenson, Scott Tucker, Will Dunn, and me as we were true daughter and sons. Love and respect shared in the family was phenomenal. Family was certainly his pride and joy. Family ties run deep in the Cooper clan, and Peter always seemed to be well informed of what was going on, not only with Kirk and Helen's family, but also with the other direct descendants of his grandfather. The Kirkland cousins, from his mother's side of the family, were also central to his life, from his early years in New Jersey and later on at Westwood and Paget. They have some wonderful stories of the mischief that they would all get up to. Peter's business career stretched an incredible 52 years at A.S. Cooper & Sons. He developed an expertise in modern and antique British pottery, starting by spending a year at Wedgwood and other fine china factories in Staffordshire, England, and became a fine retailer under the watchful eye of his grandfather and the five sons. Peter took over leadership of the company in the late 70s from his father and led the company through its heydays in the 1980s, expanding the business to 18 stores, and overseeing its development as a leading business. When asked about his career recently by Ashley, he cited the love of the product and wanting to present it in the best possible way as a key to his success. Still, many of the A.S. Cooper staff would say that it was his relationship with them and with his customers that contributed most to his success. Peter's advice was much sought after. He served on the boards of directors of several local organizations, including the Bermuda Press, the F&M, the Bank of Bermuda, and Warwick Academy, where he went against many traditionalists in supporting racial integration. Peter grew up sailing, rowing, and swimming off the Bayswater dock, and loved to be on the water. Peter sailed locally in one design keelboats, as well as in ocean races with Eldon Trimmingham and Perk. Peter was very involved with the Royal Bermuda Yacht Club, again following his father's footsteps, becoming Commodore in 1980 and 81, and serving on the Board of Governors until his death. His love of the water extended to their house at Squam Lake in New Hampshire, where he taught his grandchildren how to fish. He also had a fleet of radio-controlled sailboats up north for family fun. But as the kids got better at it, it was Papa who would lose track of whose boat was whose whilst racing them, much to the delight of the grandkids. Peter's outgoing disposition was not curtailed by technological advances and the explosion of social media that befuddled many of his generation. Rather, these advances were an enabler for him to stay connected with his family and friends around the world. While some say from time to time he might have shared too much, he enjoyed it immensely, and it was a source of amusement for the rest of the family. He insisted that his cell phone always be nearby, and most of the time it was on his person. It had to be taken from his top pocket of his PJs recently as it was getting in the way. It was when he was being helped into bed. Mackenzie recently reminded us of a ski trip a few years ago when Papa took a tumble just after lunch and had to go back inside because he'd bruised his chest from landing on his BlackBerry that was on his inside breast coat pocket. In closing, when asked, Peter said the most important character trait was honesty. There have been so many messages sent to our family expressing their sorrow at Peter's passing, for which the family is truly grateful. And almost everyone referred to Peter as a true gentleman, or as one of the nicest people they've ever met. There have been many anecdotes shared, which truly made us all smile. And so, I can honestly claim that the world has been a much better place because of Peter's influence on those around him. You'd have to go a long way, be hard-pressed to find anybody as universally loved. By my definition, he was a great man. We'll miss him, but we hope to celebrate his life by following his example. Thank you.
A reading from Revelation chapter 21, verses 1 through 7. A new heaven and a new earth. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away." He who was seated on the throne said, "I am making everything new." Then he said, "Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true." He said to me, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give water without cost from the spring of the water of life. Those who are victorious will inherit all this, and I will be their God, and they will be my children." God bless you, Uncle Peter.
Sea Fever by John Mansfield. I must go down to the seas again, to the lonely sea in the sky. And all I ask is a tall ship, a scar up just near her by. And the wheels kick, and the wind's song, and the white sail shaking. And a gray mist on the sea's face, and a gray dawn breaking. I must go down to the seas again, for the call of the running tide is a wild call and a cleared call that may not be denied. And all I ask is a windy day, with the white clouds flying, and and the flung spray, and the bones spume, and the seagulls crying. I must go down to the seas again, to the vagrant gypsy life, to the gull's way and the whale's way, where the wind's like a whetted knife. And all I ask is a merry yarn from a laughing fellow rover, and quiet sleep and a sweet dream when the long trick's over.
Let's give ourselves a time to acknowledge that understanding Peter's passing and coming to terms with the God who has taken him is a mystery. So we're going to sing hymn Immortal, Invisible, God Only Wise. In this moment, to speak into our hearts as we ponder what it is to remember and to love our brother Peter. In Jesus' name, Amen. Would you please be seated? I can't remember when it happened, but Tuppy, Barbara, and Peter sometime got around to showing me their wedding photographs. And I was oohing and ahhing in all the right places, partly because they were a completely beautiful couple. And you think, my goodness me, no wonder they found each other. And when you combine that with, of course, knowing them, you understand completely the ultimate love story that is Barbara and Peter. But there was something about these pictures that struck me, and as the minister of this church, I needed to ask a question, didn't I, Tuppy? I needed to ask, where was that picture taken? There was a really beautiful picture of them coming down the aisle and then coming out of the door. And it just didn't look right. And I thought, well, we haven't had any work done on the church. Oh, they said, that's because we came out of one door, walked all the way around, everybody followed us, and then we came back in this door and went out the door again. To me, that seems to make an awful lot of sense. It's not just about being in love. It was about presenting the right thing on the outside. So they came down this aisle, out of that door, came back in this door, and back out again with all the confetti flowing down. Now, I have to say, I've told a little bit of a fib to other couples since then. I've told them that doing that is a Paget tradition. It isn't. It's a Peter and Tuppy tradition. However, it gives us a wonderful understanding of how we can hold on to who Peter is today and how we can remember him. Because we're going to remember him because I can see so many of you here. It's incredible. I don't think I've ever put so many people in this church. Or rather, Peter has put all of you here today. So what do we do with that? Because we can't just go along doing today and then go home and then that be it. It's not enough. In this afternoon's reading, there's a beautiful picture of the relationship that God has with us, or at least wants to have with us. It says that the person having the vision, whose name is John, sees Jerusalem, the holy city, coming down from heaven, from God, like a bride adorned for her husband. And if you get to see that beautiful picture of Barbara and Peter coming out of this church, with Barbara all dressed up in her beautiful, beautiful, what is it, the bride's wear? It's not a costume. Wedding dress. We get that sense, the little looks that are between them in the photographs as they climb into the carriage down there. You can see the little looks between them make you think, my goodness me, that's a relationship where they completely love each other. And of course, those of us who know them know that that's a beautiful, beautiful story. This idea of the relationship that is between God and his bride, which is us, what we call the church, which is a funny term, this relationship is lived out in Peter and Tuppy's life. The complete way in which they know each other, and when you get to sit with them and see that they don't even need to say words to each other, you understand something. But it's not just something of Peter and Tuppy, it's of God. Peter, we have all acknowledged, is and was and will always be the kindest, gentlest, most caring, loving, compassionate, honest, and wonderful man that we could ever hope to meet. And that didn't happen by accident. I am sure that Peter was brought up beautifully, and I'm sure that it's a wonderful family that he was part of, and that he and Tuppy met each other because they have very much love to show. But I have also seen in them an acknowledgement, and particularly as I chatted with Peter over these last few months, an acknowledgement that it is God working in us that brings us into that place of peace and love that we see in him. Peter was not one to wave his religion in your face. He wasn't going to run around handing out Bibles. He wasn't the sort of man to sit down with you, perhaps, and say, let's say a prayer. But I do know that Peter was a man who was always here. And if he wasn't here, then he was with Tuppy, and I was going to them. A relationship with God, like a relationship between a man and a woman, is not a relationship of formality or of doing the same thing over and over again. A relationship with God isn't a relationship of a religiousness. It's about an honesty and an integrity and a deep love. This we can see in Peter and Tuppy. But we can also understand it as it takes us deeper into God. Today, we are able to be, as Tuppy has asked me to be, happy, light, joyful. We can be that because I can say with my hand on my heart, I know where Peter is. I know that because I saw the relationship in Peter that he had not just with his wife, but with his God. That is an amazing thing. stronger even than I could probably say about myself and God. But then, as I always said to Peter, you're closer to him than I am, of relationship with God, as well as with human beings, is that we are able to say that God will wipe away every tear from our eye, because death is no more, and mourning and crying and pain will be no more, for these things have passed away. And for Peter, they have. They have passed away. And to the degree that any of us can be sure, he was sure. And that hope is the word of comfort. The word of comfort is, the God who created you, who loves you so much, just like we see Peter and Tuppy loving each other, that sort of love God has for you and for me, that is the promise. He's not going to let you go any more than Barbara's going to let Peter go and Peter's going to let Barbara go. It's not happening. That love is eternal. It lasts way beyond anything that we might call death. Because in Jesus there is a hope. These are not religious words. These are not things I have to tell you. We can see them in Peter's life. And when we walk out of here today, that is the comfort we can take. Peter is with God. He is also with Tuppy and with you. And that's not going to change. In fact, in God, it can get even better. For as Jesus says in another place, I'm preparing a place for you. And as Jesus says in another place, trust me. These things are true if we know the man who said them. Just like knowing Peter is a joy and a blessing. And we can know and trust him because we knew him. So it is with our God. That in Jesus he has proved himself ultimately loving. Ultimately loving that he has been through death for us. So that when we have to pass that same way, it is a safe way. So that he who is seated on the other side of death says, it is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. I will be your God, and you will be my children. Let's remember Peter that way, and hold on to that love, and hold on to that hand until we pass the same way. Amen. Can I invite you now, please, to pray with me? I'm going to say some words. They may or may not be what you want to say. It's always a trouble. And I always gave, and will always give Tuppy the way to say, that isn't quite what I meant, Aunt. So when I say a prayer, I'm going to leave a little pause, and then you get to say what you want to say to God, and then we'll all say Amen together. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you. We thank you because you've made us in your own image and you've given each one of us gifts in body and mind and spirit. But we thank you today for Peter, for all that he means and has meant to each of us. And as we honour his memory today, make us more aware that you are the one from whom every perfect gift comes, including the gift of eternal life. In Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Father, the death of Peter brings an emptiness into our lives. Because we're separated from him and because we're broken, there's a disturbance between us. So please give us confidence to know that he is safe and that his life is complete with you. And bring us, we pray, together at the last, to the fullness of your presence in heaven, where your saints and angels enjoy you forever and ever. Amen. Father of all mercies and God of all consolation, you pursue us with an untiring love, and you dispel the shadow of death and give us the bright dawn of life. Your Son, Jesus Christ, by dying has destroyed our death, and by rising has restored our life. Your Holy Spirit, our Comforter, speaks to us in groans too deep for words. So come alongside your people, remind them of your eternal presence, and give them your comfort and your strength. Amen. God, our Father, we thank you that you sent your Son, Jesus Christ, to die for us and rise again. His cross declares your love to be without limit. His resurrection, that death, our last enemy, is doomed. And by his victory, we are assured of the promise that you will never leave us or forsake us. That neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come, can separate us from your love. In Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And so would you pray together with me, please, the words of the Lord's Prayer. Say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Our last hymn, entirely appropriately for a man who loves sailing quite so much, Eternal Father, strong to save, whose arms restrains the restless wave.
Thank you.
and moved to his resting place. Can I also say that at the end, you're all invited to go along to the Royal Bermuda Yacht Club to continue sharing memories. Can I also ask that once we have laid Peter to rest, you give the family their own time and space. Please don't mob them afterwards. There's an awful lot of us here. Perhaps the best thing to do is to go straight to the Yacht Club and meet them there. For now, let's keep a moment of silence together. A moment of love and respect. A moment of remembrance and hope as we hold and commend Peter before God. Peter Newbold Cooper has fallen asleep in the peace of Christ. We entrust him with faith and hope in everlasting life to the love and the mercy of our Father, and surround him with our love and our prayer. In baptism, Peter was made by adoption a child of God. At the Eucharist, he was sustained and fed. Now, God welcomes him to his table in heaven to share in eternal life with all the saints. Amen. As we make this journey, may God go with us. May he show us all that he is and shine his light on our pathway, for our footsteps will fall without his support and love. But with him, all is peace and light and everlasting hope. To him be glory and praise forever. Amen.
Unplug the phone. And am I going to lose it at that point, or is it going to keep on going?